Okay, good morning, everybody. Okay, I'm very glad to have the opportunity to teach microeconomics to you this semester. Today, we're going to learn chapter 1. Before going to chapter 1, I'd like to say a few words about the author of this book and textbook you use. Okay, so the author of your textbook is called Michael Parkin. Michael Parkin is an international famous economist. He was the president of the Economic Association in Canada twice, and he was the chairman of the Department of Economics at the University of Western Ontario, where I studied for 2 years. So I know him quite well, and lucky enough, he paid a one-week visit to our university in 2004, and I remember very well, he gave us 2 lectures to our graduate students and undergraduate students. So that's the occasion that he gave lecture to our students, and I welcome both of them at the airport, unless we have some meeting, and we visit Lausanne once. That's a small gift from our university. Okay, that's a little bit of introduction about your author. Since we get good relation with the author, we'd like to use his book as our textbook. So, that's the textbook you have. Okay. This is called the International Edition. And this is 9th edition. 10th edition is available now. But now we're going to use 9th edition. So, that's a little bit short introduction to the author, to the textbook. Of course, as you may know that this textbook is very, very famous internationally and can be compared to Samuelson's textbook, Mankiewicz's textbook. Anyway, let's go to chapter 1. We'd like to give a short introduction to what is economics. So chapter 1, what is economics? 第一章, 什么是经济学? After studying this chapter, you will be able to define economics and distinguish between microeconomics and macroeconomics. 学这章可以了解什么叫经济学, 什么叫微观经济学, 以及大宏观经济的区别. Explain the 2 big questions of economics. 经济学中的两大问题. Explain the key ideas that define economic way of thinking. 经济学思考问题的方式有哪些? 怎样思考问题才算是经济学思考问题方式? Economic way of thinking. Explain how economists go about their work as social scientists. 经济学家是如何工作的? 他做什么事儿? 大家可能关心的. So that's basically what we're going to do today. So first of all, and the most important, how can we define economics? What is economics? Is a key issue in this chapter. 归根到底，我们要讨论什么叫经济学。 But how can we get conclusion what is economics? So let's begin from some basic economic problems or economic issues that we face each day. All economic questions arise because we want more than we can get. We also want more. Okay? So let's assume what we want if they're free of charge. Free of charge. They're free to get. If they're free to get, as a human being, we always want more and more, better and better. Is that right? Yes, great. So, you may want a beautiful car, you may want a beautiful house, or beautiful wife, or beautiful husband and wife, or happy family. That's all you want. So, In my opinion, greediness may be one of the human beings' natures. 可能一个基的基本假设，贪婪可能是人的天性之一。People always want more and better. But unfortunately, the resources to produce goods and services to satisfy our wants are limited. 那关键是什么呢？资源。去生产这些产品和服务的资源是什么？有限的。如果资源是无限的，那也好办，是吧？想多少有多少，那好办。But this is not true. So we know two sides of the story. One side, human beings' wants are unlimited, but resources are limited. Or in ability to satisfy all our wants is called scarcity. Scarcity, 稀缺性，就是满足于我们欲望的那些资源，生产产品的资源是有限的，是稀缺的。那么这个稀缺是一种事实，以至于我们要用个法则来去说 The law of scarcity被称为稀缺法则。The law of scarcity states that society has insufficient productive resources to fulfill all human wants and needs. 稀缺法则什么说？稀缺法则说是用于满足我们愿望的那些资源是稀缺的。当然这是一个原始的一个定义，我们还可以做它做一个引申。中国有句古话叫什么？物以稀为贵，是稀缺法则的中文版。那我们看看它的引理， The law of scarcity or scarcity principle， 稀缺法则或者叫做这个稀缺原理是什么东西呢？It states that if what you desire is in limited supply or seemingly limited supply, its perceived value increases. 这个引力 很有意思啊！他这样说，如果你所想要的东西在供给方面是有限的，或者它看上去是有限的，实际上可能不是有限的，那么你对它的评判的价值会上升。啊，我们说这是稀缺法则的一个引申。那这个引申呢，就很有意思了。So this also increases the urge for people to want it or to want it neededly. 换句话说，你越感觉它稀缺，你越想要它。当一件东西非常富裕、数量非常多的时候，或者不那么稀缺的时候，你想要它的心情有没有那么迫切啊？那因此这个定理可以用来做什么呢？ What can we do with this law? So we can apply this law to business. If you are a salesman, what can you do? You will tell the consumer how limited the supply of our good is. So please get quickly as possible. Right? 你可以告诉大家，我说我这个产品很紧缺了，就是要一件了，买不买？当听说只有一件了，你可能很快怎么样？你 take out your money to buy it. 还有一个，我们造成稀缺来提升它的价值的时候，或物以稀为贵的时候，我们还可以应用到日常生活。有时候比方说男女之间，如果女同学跟男同学天天泡在一起，它的价值会怎么样？很低，它太容易得到了。有时候若隐若离的会增加这个女孩子在男同学当中心目当中什么价值。 OK， 所以这个也可以用到 daily life. So we can apply the law of scarcity to our business as well as our life, daily life. So since we have scarcity, we have to make a choice. 这一点转折很重要，因为是稀缺嘛，所以我们就要选择。But we have so many choices to make each day. Let's see what kind of choice we have. To turn right or left? That's the question. 向左转向右转有时候是个问题，不知道路的时候。To be or not to be? That's the question. To give up or to go on? That's the question. Sometimes to live or die? That's the question. 这里很多都是英语中的一个非常典型的说法。To be or not to be, that's the question. 所以说我们选择非常艰难，但是我们必须做的选择。So, the choice we make depends on the incentives we face. 但我们做选择是基于什么来选择呢？我们凭什么去选择呢？是基于一种激励 incentives。我们对不同的激励可能会做出什么不同的选择。What incentive? An incentive is a reward for encourages an action or a penalty that discourages an action. 这个激励啊有正反面，要么是正向激励奖励，要么是负向激励惩罚。比方说在大学里面，我们总是有一些制度来激励同学们努力学习，来惩罚那些学生不努力读书的学生。 So in schools we have some rules to reward some students who study hard and punish some students who do not study hard. 反过来，如果一个大学的激励制度是相反的，这个大学还有必要办吗？激励 incentive matters， 激励是非常重要的。这是一个世界上最长的亲吻比赛。为什么搞这个亲吻比赛呢？目前是亲吻的46小时最长，是因为后面有钻戒有激励。我们看动物表演的时候，其实有没有激励啊？每次都是拿一个什么东西给它吃一点，给它吃一点，它就按照那个驯养师的指令去做，如果不给它吃它就不做，所以对它也怎么样，也要激励，只不过他没有人那么聪明，没有人那么 complicated, sophisticated. So, what is your incentive to study at a university? 就问大家，你在大学学习的激励是什么？谁跟我说一下？谁回答这个问题？ So, everybody has some incentives to do something, right? 每个人做什么事情都有什么？都有一种激励。或者叫什么 motivation 动机。在犯罪学当中，动机是用的什么最多的，表示杀人动机， the motivation of killing a person. Why? 这是很重要的，是吧？有时候没有一个人没有杀人动机，你就很难去推断他可能杀人。对，所以动机 or incentives isvery important matter for you to make your decision. So no matter what you do, or whatever choice you make, you have to pay a price for it. 这里转到另一个话题，就不管你做了什么选择，你总得付出代价。What kind of price you have to make? The price is called as opportunity cost. 你做选择所付出的代价，我们把它称之为机会成本。What is opportunity cost?Opportunity cost is the best alternative that we forgone or give up. We make a choice or a decision. 机会成本的概念非常重要。他说啊，当我们做出一个决定的时候，我们放弃了另外这个最佳的选择，就是我们什么机会成本。Okay, there are so many examples we can give you.To tell you what is opportunity cost. For example, you came to my classroom, you give up something, right? And this year you give up sleeping. 大家在听课至少放弃点东西啊，比方说放弃睡觉，你们在假期的时候是不是睡到12点，至少是你们付代价。但是你们在上课之前可能有很多种选择，是很多种选择里面的那个最佳选择才是你来听课的什么机会成本。然后如果你爸爸来了看你来了，你来听我的课，如果你评价你爸爸来看你的这个收益很大或者最大，那你来听我课的机会成本就是放弃了和爸爸一起聊天的什么机会成本。 So the opportunity cost for you to come to my classroom is that you lose the chance to talk to your father or something else. 机会成本。 So it's also known as the value of the best available alternative which can be resulted after making a decision. 有时候啊，我们再来衡量机会成本，当我们做了一个决定之后，那个其他可能出现的最好的那个结果，比方说如果说大家不上大学的机会成本是什么，不上大学机会成本是什么，是你大学某个同班同学他上了某个大学，他后面改变了什么什么东西，出现了一种令人振奋的一个结果。有人说你看，如果我上大学我也会跟他那样，因此我不上大学的机会成本就是我失去的一个那样的。网瘾 Internet Addiction 有没有机会成本？ Is there any opportunity cost for Internet Addiction? 有没有？它的机会成本是什么？What is the opportunity cost for internet addiction? So if you pay too much time on the internet, then you lose the chance to be with your friends, your family, and you even have no incentive to study hard. It's possible that you may be kicked out by the university, or you may be kicked out.That's life. 如果网瘾过度被大学开除也不是什么新鲜事。所以我要奉劝大家一几句，要避免网瘾。 OK, let's summarize what we learned so far. We know that resources are limited. Sorry, we have some problem here. 有限的资源，无限的什么欲望，我是欲望。So we get some scarcity, and we have to make a choice. Then we have opportunity cost, right? We have opportunity. What's opportunity cost? We have several choices that we can make, but only one choice that we can choose. The best alternative that we gave up is the opportunity cost of our choice.So, that's a summarization of what we learned so far. Okay, marriage. Is there any opportunity cost for marriage? 婚姻有没有机会成本？按照目前的法律 ,according to the law of marriage in China, or in most countries, there is one husband, one wife rule, 一夫一妻制。所以你当你和某一个人结婚的时候，你失去了什么？ What do you lose? 有人说我失去了自由，失去了单身汉的自由，甚至失去了和其他男士或者女士结婚的什么权利。但人生很纠结，不结婚呢又很孤独，所以人生就在这么一种纠结的场下做出个选择。有些的选择结婚，更多的选择结婚一个世俗的观点等等，但也有的选择什么一辈子不结婚。那么一辈子不结婚它付出代价是什么？晚年是非常孤独难过的，他以前半辈子的快乐要换取后半辈子什么的孤独，这也是人生的纠结。但不管怎么样，Everybody has to make a choice to decide. You get married or remain single. Okay. Or something else. 如果我们想想, 离婚, divorce is not allowed. If divorce is not allowed, what's going to happen? 如果离婚是不允许的, 那么这是不是增加了结婚的成本? 是不是? 我们有理由相信, 如果离婚不被允许, 结婚率会下降。 你们大家害怕结婚。 万一犯错误一下, you have to pay a price for your life. 当然结婚应该慎重, 本来就应该慎重, 但至少还让你一个改正错误的什么? 机会, 这很重要。 So, now it's time for us to make conclusion. What economics is? Economics is a social science that studies the choice that individuals, businesses, and governments, and entire societies make as they cope with scarcity and the incentives that influence and reconcile those choices. This definition comes out from your textbook, from Michael Parkin. 我们来仔细的来分析一下这个定义。 这个定义分了两部分说，一部分说经济学是关于研究某个选择的学问，对吧？谁做选择呢？这里有家庭、个人，在座的各位 individuals，另外还有企业、生产单位，还有政府 ，individuals, business, government have to make some choices。 以及整个抽象的社会，类似于中国何处去，整个社会要做出选择。第二，我们还要研究什么？研究人们做出这些选择的激励是什么？应该强调，帕金的这个定义比大多数定义多了第二部分，强调了 incentives 的重要性。So Michael Parkin emphasizes the importance of incentive. As you know, no single definition of economics can adequately capture the subject. For that reason, let's see some more of it. 让我们看看更多的定义. First of all, let's talk something about the father of economics, Adam Smith. 经济学之父, Adam Smith. As far as I know, it's a good idea to know who is the father of economics. We first learn economics. 当大家首先学经济学的时候, 最好知道谁是经济学之父, Adam Smith. Adam Smith wrote the first book in economics entitled As an Inquiry into the Nature and the Causes of Wealth of Nation. 简称 The Wealth of Nation, 国富论, How to make a country stronger and wealthier, 如何使一个国家更加昌盛富强，是 Adam Smith 在 1790. So, from Adam Smith, economics is just science of wealth. 以阿德·史密斯来说，经济学是什么？就是研究财富的一门科学，研究如何增进财富的一门学问。But what is wealth? 什么是财富呢？ Wealth means goods and services transacted with the help of money. 所谓财富，是指用 货币去交换的那些产品和什么服务，最早强调 wealth 只强调它是实物产品，后面把服务也看作是一种财富，因为我们也需要用钱去交换。 要知道，所谓的 goods or TV set or camera, that's goods. Service, for example, my education service, 我的教育是一种服务。但是我们现在对财富有更广泛的定义，物质财富和什么精神财富，那精神财富就多着呢。从法律上讲，赔偿一个人精神损失是什么最难的，对，衡量一个人精神损失是非常艰难的事情，但有时候我们必须去做出一个计算。 Unfortunately, we have no the mother of economics, 我们没有经济学之母，只有经济学之父。另外一个伟大经济学家 马歇尔 He defines economics as follows. Economics is the study of mankind in the ordinary business life. 经济学啊，是关于人们一般商务生活的人的行为的一种研究啊。经济学是研究一般商务生活的学问，一般商务活动的学问。这个定义也比较接近于是研究人们选择的学问。Marshall was a British economist. Another greatest economist, Paul Samuelson, 保罗·塞缪森，还有一本非常著名的教材 Samuelson Economics. 这我看来有三部教材在国际上是非常著名的。一个是塞缪森的，第二是曼昆的，第三是我们这本帕金的。这三本书在某种程度上这我看的是齐名的，各有特色，各有千秋，是你可以说帕金教材 is the best. Samuelson says that economics is a study of how societies use scarce resources to produce valuable commodities and distribute them among different people. Let's take a close look about this definition. 那我们再认真看看这个定义。这个定义首先强调经济学要研究什么？生产，是吧？研究生产。怎么生产呢？是利用稀缺资源去生产有价值的产品。有价值产品，或者是人们想要的产品，对不对？所以经济学首先研究生产。它的定义里面比其他定义多了一个 How to distribute these commodities to different people， 如果把这个生产产品分配给社会公众。因此它强调什么？生产和分配。大家首先要有个概念，经济学最重要的研究的是生产，我其实要研究消费，还要研究分配。所以有些定义可以说经济学是研究生产、消费、交换和分配的一门学问。这是按照几个环节，生产环节、交换环节、消费环节以及收入分配环节，以四个环节来说经济学是干嘛的。So from this definition, we understand Samuelson emphasizes on the importance of distribution, because distribution may influence the structure of production. Samuelson 呢，他是强调收入分配可能会影响到生产，特别是当一个社会收入分配严重不公的时候，人们生产的积极性是怎么样？受到严重的挫伤。当你付出很多的劳动得到很少，而人家付出很少的劳动得到很多的时候，你觉得你付出更多劳动有意义吗？没意义。没意义的办法一个选择怎么样？少劳动。如果一个社会很多人都少劳动，这个社会所创造出的产品是不是会更少？所以公平的收入分配是激励生产的一个重要方面。And Paul Samuelson won Nobel Prize in 1970. 他是美国第一个荣获诺贝尔经济学奖的。He died several years ago. 在他逝世前，他是那个时代最最伟大的经学家。如果要说在他活的时候谁是那个世界最伟大的经学家，如果要说一个人名字，霍塞纳斯。他的这本经济学教材是很多经济学家的教材，他是经济学教授的教授，他培养当今一代经济学家。Let's see some other definitions of economics, which you may find interesting. 我们再看看其他一些定义，可能会有兴趣。Economics is a science that deals with the study of production and the distribution of a country's resources. 经济学是一门科学，它研究如何去研究生产以及一个国家资源的分配，或者叫配置。经济学是研究如何生产以及如何分配。Economics is a social science that deals with the study of utilization of a country's natural resources. 经济学啊，是研究如何有效地利用这个国家自然资源的一门学问。这强调的是什么？ Natural resources。当然，这个定义更多的可以说的是叫做 natural resources economics 啊，自然资源的经济学。它的定义比较窄啊，仅仅强调 resources, natural resources。Economics is a social science that deals with the study of how people can be influenced by economic system around them. 这个定义非常好。它强调什么呢？强调人们的选择是如何受到一个经济制度的影响。比方说你在大学里面会不会认真学习，其实受到那个大学制度的影响。这个大学学分好不好，制度严厉不严厉等等，都会影响到人们的行为。因此这个定义强调经济体制，强调经济制度。那这个定义也可以说是制度经济学的一种定义， Institutional Economics, 或者叫做 Economics of Economic Systems, 经济制度的经济学，研究经济制度的经济学。And economics divides into two main parts. 经济学分成了两大类， microeconomics and macroeconomics, 微观经济学和宏观经济学。Today, you deal with microeconomics. What's microeconomics? Microeconomics is a study of choices that individuals and businesses make. The way those choices interact in markets,and the influence of the government. What's microeconomics is? Microeconomics is a study of the performance of the national and global economies. 微观经济学是研究单个企业、单个个人的经济活动的一门学问，而宏观经济学是把一个国家或者整个全球作为一个总体来进行研究的一门学问。因此微观经济学也被称之为个体经济学或者个量经济学，宏观经济学也被称之为总体经济学。Microeconomics look at the individual units, the household, the firm, the industry. It seesand examines the trees. Macroeconomics looks at the whole, the aggregate. It sees and analyzes the forest. 这个比喻很好。微观经济学是看树，而宏观经济学呢，森林。一个是研究树木， 一个是研究森林，是不是两个都有必要学研究？研究树木有没有意义？肯定要研究，这不是研究哪一个树种，对不对？这个树种会怎么成长规律？这是微观经济学。宏观经济学呢，怎么来保护一片森林？显然两个都有其价值。当我们有时候批评一些人只见树木不见森林，但反过来也不行呢，只见森林不见树木，有这样的情况吗？ OK, now we have a diagram or table to show the differences between microeconomics and macroeconomics. 这里是一张表啊，简要的回顾了一下宏微观经济学的一些区别。They are different in the area of production, prices, income, and employment. 简单的说，微观经济学是研究单个企业的产量，宏观经济学是研究的国家的产量。区别了，价格，微观经济学研究单个企业的价格，宏观经济学研究一个经济总体的价格水平。Similarly, microeconomics deal with each individual's income, but macroeconomics deal with the income distribution for the nation as a whole. So, there are similar differences between the two. 经济学还可以做一些分类，做一些分类。这里我们简要说一下，要分成了Competitive Economic System, 比较经济体制，是经济学下面的一个分类。Econometrics, 计量经济学。Economic Development, 经济发展 ,which studies the pattern of development structure in, developing countries. Economic History, 经济史。Economics of race and gender, 种族和性别经济学。大家经常看报纸看到啊，美国黑人怎么样，白人的收入怎么样啊，男性收入怎么样，女性收入怎么样。Finance, 金融。The history of economic thought, 经济思想史。Industrial organization, 产业组织学。International economics, 国际经济学。Labor economics, 劳动经济学。Law and economics, 这个很有兴趣啊，很有意思。Law and economics, 法律与经济学。这简称说法经济学。不能翻成经济法啊。经济法是纯粹从法律角度来研究经济类别的一些法律。这个法与经济学是 is combination of the law and economics。Public economics, 公共经济学 ,such as public finance, 公共财政。Urban and regional economics, 城市与区域经济学。这是经济学的大致分类，一些主要课程。如果大家将来有机会到国外去留学的话，这是一些经济学系要开设出的课程。So, the above courses are offered in foreigners department of economics, which are the major branches in economics. I think you'll find interesting, to study in the future. Okay, let's have a break.